see myself in a pickled boat.
I'm the kind of decent little homie gonna be like on the prayer in the street, saying prayer in the street. I've been spending most of my life living in the gangster's paradise.
1, 2, 3, 4.
It's 10:05 on Thursday evening, and David O'Doherty has begun his latest fitness drive by cycling into his comedy gig. He is late.
Dave, are you here?
Yeah, it's fine.
You're gonna really love this, guys. Go fucking nuts, make a lot of noise. Please welcome to the stage, David O'Doherty!
There is no time to catch his breath. He is straight on.
Yeah. Right.
They call me David O'Doherty because it's on my birth certificate. 18, 12, 7, 5, and quarter past 8. Youngest of 3. 7 years to the last. Was I planned? I don't know. I've never asked. Motherfucking yeah.
Next, David announces his big news to the audience.
I've decided that I'm going to try and get healthy. I like sport a lot, I have to say. I think I like going to major sporting events. And I think the main thing about that is that life generally doesn't give you many opportunities to shout at people who are much better than you at a thing. You can't just wander into your local hospital and go, ah, you're shit. Give them a drip.
It's not the first time David has gone on a health kick.
I made the supreme commitment to good health in May of this year. In May, I bought my first ever box of muesli. Now that is serious, because muesli is without doubt the single most depressing substance known to man. It's basically misery in a material form. Breakfast has traditionally been quite a happy meal for me, and it's reflected by breakfast cereals, which are kind of happy. You know, they have a cartoon character on the front. You know, you're gonna have a whale of a day, and you know how I know that? Because I'm Brian the Chocolatey Whale. It's not like that with muesli. No way. If muesli were to have a picture on the front, and it wouldn't, because that would be too happy. It'd be an old lady crying. Like, it helps me shit.
After the show, David breaks the news to his friends over a salad.
You know, I'm going to do tomorrow. I'm going to buy a pair of runners. I'm going to get proper runners, not runners with lights or wheels in them.
Runners with the spikes in them.
His neighbour Brian isn't convinced that this will make David healthy.
I've been around watching the telly all day wearing a pair of runners, you know?
No. I'm starting a regime. I haven't exactly figured out what I'm going to do in the regime yet. But it's going to involve a lot more green things and a lot less beige things. I was very fit till I was about 15, 16. And I've let slip a bit for the last 14 years. But I'm back.
Next morning, David heads for the sports shop in pursuit of the perfect footwear.
What are the very, very best shoes for running around in?
Shell Cayano. Oh, number yeah. 12.
What do these do that's good?
Well, high level of the cushioning, first of all. Geomax is going to help you now.
Oh, yeah.
Reduce this bad step and make the step. Extra ankle support. This is the biomorphic technology. They're very flexible. Plus, you get very, 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 I repeat, very good arch support. Very breathable, you know.
How much are they, Darius?
140.
Okay. What's the step down from them?
Step down.
Whoa, okay.
You know the biomorphic technology?
Yeah.
They're not so flexible and not so breathable like that. You're getting technology support and, first of all, quality.
Do you have those in 12?
Those guys?
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Apparently, this is real metal they use on them, and you can melt these down and make a car.
Like Cinderella, David has found his shoes.
Whoa. And these are on sale at the moment.
$59.99.
Woo! Let's go. Let's buy these.
Try to be best, cause you're only a man, and a man's got to learn to take it. Try to believe, though the going gets rough, that you gotta hang tough to make it. History repeats itself, try and you succeed. Never die.
One day in, and David has had enough.
It's like a boring job or something.
I need to think of something else. I need something with a goal, something with an ending to it.
Next morning, he can feel the effects of his regime. But during a night of cramp and intense leg ache, he has had an idea.
I've got a new plan. I have a gig next Monday in Galway, and I've decided that I am going to cycle to that gig. That'll give me the sort of end point that I need to really get somewhere with this getting healthy plan. It's pretty far, I know. It's like 2.5 hours in the train, but I don't know how fast does a train go? A train goes faster than a bike, sure, but probably not that much faster. So there isn't going to be time to do any training as such. But when I was 14, I used to cycle a lot. So it'll just be a question of getting back that. You know, I think with riding a bike, you never forget how to ride a bike.
David begins his preparations for the journey ahead back at his parents' house.
This was my room. Some of my stuff is still left here, though. This is probably my favourite book for a long time. Breakdancing, Let Conlon Vean, I'll Show You How. I guess I must have got it for my confirmation. So, for your confirmation, I received the Holy Spirit, but I also received Breakdancing, Let Conlon Vean, I'll Show You How. Whenever anyone asks what is your favourite book of all time, I don't say Breakdancing. I still always say this. Stephen Roach is the only proper hero that I've ever had. There were Stephen Roach posters all over this room, and I made my mother buy the specific brand of cheese that he used to endorse. I joined the cycling club that he had joined when he was my age, because I wanted to become a professional cyclist.
In the bottom of the wardrobe, David finds his old cycling gear.
Here now.
That's my cycling jersey there. It's got the pockets at the back. I've probably put on a little weight since 1990, but I'm sure I'll still fit into it. It'll be even more aerodynamic now. So there's your classic cycling shorts right there. They stay upright because they have a huge piece of sponge in the undercarriage. These are called cycling overshoes. They eliminate wind resistance or the potential of you talking to a girl while you're wearing them.
Next, it's to the bike shop, and David has the bicycle he paid €30 for in an auction evaluated by an expert.
How's it going?
How are you?
I'm all right. I need some advice as much as anything.
Yeah.
I'm cycling to Galway on this. What do you think this needs?
Needs a saddle, a set of mudguards for these weather conditions.
Bottle. Next, they talk nutrition, and David learns of the dreaded knock.
What would you eat, Nev?
A banana. A Mars bar in your back pocket.
Eat bananas, yeah.
That fills you.
Okay, yeah.
As soon as you feel as though you're empty inside, you get the knock.
Right, what's that?
It's the most horrible thing. The body just says no.
And you just can't go on anymore?
You just can't.
Right, yeah.
The key thing is, this time of year, have enough food there.
Well, I better get a puncture repair kit.
The first start.
All right.
It's time to plan the route to Galway.
We're trying to go from here to about here. Which doesn't really seem that far when you look at it like that.
To here. How far is that?
David remembers an old trick from scouts for calculating distance on a map. Unfortunately, he can't remember what to do next. So he checks the distance on the internet instead.
The drive from Dublin to Galway is 140 miles and will take approximately 3 hours. It's fine.
How fast can you go on a bike? Does anyone know?
To calculate his average speed, David has devised an elaborate plan.
You just drive half a mile in that direction, stop, you phone me, and when you phone me, start the watch, and then we'll see how long it takes me to do half a mile, and then we'll multiply that by 280.
Yeah.
And start the clock when you give me a ring.
Yeah, I'll be waiting. Put your phone on you.
Yeah, I've got it. I'll be waiting for you.
Okay.
Okay, go.
David waits for the signal, then rides off. But when he gets to the van, he will find out that the call was not from Brian, but from his mother, to ask him to come around and cut the grass. His next plan is foolproof.
Okay, this time, it's hard to tell with the wind.
Yeah?
But I'm going to try and just cycle at the speed that I will cycle at normally. Okay, and you just check your speed out and find out what we're doing.
Okay.
Okay?
You're up at 14.
Nice. If I take, say, 2 hours of brakes along the way, that's about 12 hours then.
To Galway?
Well, if I can do 14, and 14's a bit hard, as long as it's not wet or windy.
You want to give it a bit of fucking welly though as well. You don't want to be cutting people's grass on the way down.
I know. Okay. Let's go.
Go on!
Before retiring for the evening, David and Brian have one more test to carry out. David feels that if they can exploit the violent chemical reaction between Diet Coke and Mentos mints, they could create a beverage-powered bicycle engine.
Oh, shit.
Yeah.
The test pilot dons a protective outer layer, and they're ready for launch.
Okay. One, two, three, go.
It has no propulsive effect whatsoever.
Anything? Ah, shit!
As darkness falls and the wind picks up, the omens are not good for the journey ahead. A trip David will now be making on a very sticky bike. The crew wake David early to begin his epic quest.
Hey, David. David. David!
Good morning.
It hasn't been an ideal night's rest.
I got about 2 hours sleep. I was thirsty before I went to sleep, and there was nothing else to drink. I drank about over half a bottle at about two, and then lay there twitching in bed like a drug addict.
Next, he checks the internet for the latest weather. The forecast is not good.
Blustery at first, with some scattered showers, but many places dry and bright. That's partially positive. Rain developing in the southwest. Not going there. Well, kind of going there. Currently, there is a gale warning in effect and a small craft warning as well. I wouldn't describe a bicycle as a craft. It's more like a tiny vehicle.
He has assembled a variety of snacks for the trip.
Bananas. There, that's for tracking. Tiffin is what Protestants have instead of chocolate. The guy in the bike shop said to get stuff with glucose, but they didn't have glucose, so I got fizzy colas instead.
David has a secret weapon to go inside his sandwiches.
I got the cheese that Stephen Roach used to endorse. Although I'm not sure if he used to eat it, or maybe he just used to slice it up and put it into his shorts for padding.
Soon it's time to see if his cycling gear from 17 years ago still fits. For extra insulation, he has borrowed a pair of ladies' woolen yoga leggings from a neighbour.
That's pretty snug.
He fills his pockets and takes one final safety precaution.
The thing I like most about it is that they decided to put a hot lady on the front of it. The idea that someone might go, I don't really need a high-vis vest, but, cool, she's all right. Give me six of them.
He prepares his keyboard and amp for the long journey and secures them to his tiny vehicle. But before setting off, he has an important warning for the crew.
Now, the key to this is that this has to be as honest a quest, if you like, as possible, right? So you guys can film it, but under no circumstances are you allowed to help me at any point, okay? So no matter how much I ask, do not let me into the car. Do not do anything for me, okay?
Brian has gotten up to bid his friend farewell.
What are you going to say at the gig?
I'll probably open with my hole is really sore.
See ya.
And so, with his underpants partially exposed, he takes off into the early morning traffic.
How are you feeling?
Excellent. It's starting to rain a little bit, but I can't imagine that'll last much longer. This is Ireland. What have we done?
We've done almost 30 kilometres.
We're 1/200th of the way there, then.
But as he turns to the west, he is struck by the wind for the first time.
God!
David wonders whether it is illegal to wee in a rural hedge.
I know it is if you do it, like, in a town. But I think it's all right if you're dressed like this. In the Tour de France, they actually wee while they're cycling along off the side of the bike. But in the Tour de France, they don't have an amp and a keyboard attached to the back of their bikes. I wouldn't really be into playing this at the gig if it was covered in man wee. Right, let's go.
One-third distance, the wind and rain temporarily subside. And although damp and tired, David is doing his best to remain positive.
There's blue sky there. That's not there. That doesn't exist. That's all in your mind. It's about positivity at this stage, not about looking at clouds.
At 1 o'clock, after 6 hours in the saddle, David suffers his first major setback. Once again, he attempts to see the bright side.
I'm actually glad this has happened because it's an opportunity to experience some of nature. That's fine. Give that about 30 seconds. Does anyone see the thing?
But as soon as the tube inflates, it deflates again.
Well, this isn't great. Seems like there's 4 or 5 holes in the tube now.
In order to proceed, David will need a new tube.
Yeah, we'll lock this here and come back again in a while.
But now, the promise he made the crew take earlier is coming back to haunt him.
This surely doesn't count as help. This is a tube.
He must look for help elsewhere.
Hello, Brian. If you were just knocking around, if you could drop a tube out here, that'd be great. I'll find out exactly where I am and text you, okay? So he's gonna come now and... they might have a tube.
Now all David can do is wait for his tube to arrive.
We're somewhere in the Midlands. Waiting for a bicycle tube. I'm somewhere in the Midlands and I've eaten most of the food. Had lots of cola bottles, a banana, and all I've got left is a sandwich with Stephen Roach cheese in it.
After 2 hours, Brian arrives with his tube.
Just 1 second. Wednesday. Are you waiting long?
No. That's fine, just hanging out.
Cheers, Matt. All right. Good luck.
But as David sets off again, the weather worsens drastically.
Let's head to Met Aaron now, and joining us today is Michael Cleary.
Thanks, Ronan, and a very good afternoon. Atlantic rain belts are crossing Ireland in a strengthening south-to-southwest airflow. Wind south-to-southwest, backing south-to-southeast for a time this afternoon. Force 6 to gale, force 8.
His legs have gone numb, and his ladies' yoga leggings have waterlogged. At 4 o'clock, after 9 hours in the saddle, the crew have news for David.
Okay, so David! David, dude, it's getting very dark to film here. We're not getting very much. We're thinking of heading on.
Seeing the discomfort he is in, they offer to take him to Galway with them.
Isn't that a good idea? Are you sure you don't want to just call this off and put the bike in the boot?
Okay, I'll be it again.
With less than 100 kilometres to his destination, David O'Doherty isn't about to quit. It's not what Stephen Roach would have done.
As soon as you feel empty, you get a knock. The body just says no. You get a knock. Horrible feeling. The body just says no. You get a knock.
Uh-oh.
20 minutes later, David pulls over for a wee to find that his legs have stopped working. He has been struck by the knock, the curse of the unprepared cyclist. He has no option but to phone the crew and ask for a lift to Galway. This adventure has ended in failure. 3 hours later, Maeve Higgins introduces David in front of a small, damp crowd in Galway.
He might look a bit decrepit. I would if I had cycled 3,000 miles. 3,000 miles. Please put your hands together and show loads of love to Mr. David O'Doherty, everybody.
Although physically shattered, David is keen to talk about his journey.
I think the worst omen of all was small craft warning, in effect. I wasn't sure exactly if bicycle came under small craft, but I think I've proven that it does. Hang on, I'm getting a cramp now.
His body, however, is in no mood for stand-up comedy.
Hey, a funny thing happened to me on the way to the gig this evening, folks. I literally nearly died of exhaustion.
David has learned some important lessons from his failure. To remember to prepare, to always carry a spare tube, that it takes more than just desire to emulate a cycling hero, and most important of all, that perhaps his true talents lie elsewhere.
I grew up thinking I was just an ordinary kid, just doing things that ordinary kids did. But years passed me and I began to see certain strange abilities. I'm not a hero, but I'm not a freak. I just have very mild superpowers. Very mild superpowers. Like sometimes when I'm cycling with headphones on, I can predict exactly where I'll be at the end of a song. Very mild superpowers. Frequently in kitchens where I've never been, I can sense the location of the cups and crockery. My ass is sore. I'm going to bed. Thank you very much.
But before bed, David insists that they pay a visit to a nearby restaurant.
Get me chocolate milkshake, chips, onion rings and chicken things.
You want to do the health thing?
No.
Anymore? Okay.
Done.
I'll be back in a second.
Thanks.
David's health kick is over.
You know, for years, I'd look at the pop charts and go, wow, most of that's pretty rubbish. I bet I could do something not necessarily better than that,
but equally as rubbish.
It's not easy being modest, but David O'Doherty is giving it his best shot.
I don't want a hit. I want a minor hit.
That's difficult.
My vocal style, people do compare it to Michael Jackson a lot.
The Modest Adventures of David O'Doherty, next Tuesday at 10:50 on RTE2.